and I've made my wife, Bobby Clemmer, is out there somewhere buried amongst the places. Our second visit to this congregation, we came about a year ago. We moved to Greensboro 2 years ago because the sun shines in North Carolina more than it does in Pittsburgh. In fact, it shines more in a month than it does in Pittsburgh in a year, it seems like. We're pleased to be here. Thank you, Tom, for the invitation. I began as a young person with great faith in America, seemingly boundless optimism about the future, and fascination with technology. I just knew we would all be commuting by plane or helicopter, living with robotic kitchens and using wrist televisions. But then I had just entered high school. Four little girls were killed on Birmingham Sunday. A minister died on the Selma March. Three young men were killed and buried in a dam in Mississippi. And a Detroit mother down registering voters in Alabama was killed. I lost some of my optimism. By the way, three Unitarians, one Unitarian died in each of those three experiences. I once thought we could save Vietnam from communism. Then atrocities filled our television screens, a little girl running naked from her village, an interrogator shooting a prisoner in the head, and so many other examples that we feared My Lai was not the worst, nor even that unusual an experience. I lost a little more optimism. They shot President Kennedy and Martin Luther King Jr., Bobby Kennedy and Medgar Evers, and I lost a little bit more optimism. I had faith in the women's movement. And let's say no more about the Sanitarians. But it hasn't succeeded quite like we hoped 40 years ago. I thought technology could end poverty and war and illness. We're making some progress on illness. We're not making much progress on ending war and poverty. And I thought the church was the beloved community. But as a minister, I found that church people act just like everybody else. In 1969, I had the most amazing opportunity as a theological student. Beginning then and for 2 years, I worked, including 4 months living in residence, for Daybreak, affiliated with L'Arche, the international movement started by Jacques Vanier. Daybreak is a home for mentally limited adults, mostly Down syndrome, but some birth defects and some accidents, just north of Toronto. When I lived there, it was a mile to the bus stop. Now it's all surrounded by suburbia in North America's fourth largest city. You might not believe living in sight was a blessing. After all, the residents were often ill. They required much care and attention. And the mental, physical, and spiritual demands on the staff often left us drained. Daybreak had been a farm and then a home for tubercular nuns. But the number of nuns began to increase. And a former student at Trinity College, where I was in divinity school, and a follower of Vanier had started Daybreak on the site. He'd been there a couple of years and they clearly needed to make some modifications if it were going to be a long-term experiment. I visited with him and we became friends, for the dean had told him I had a degree in architecture. While working with Daybreak, I designed a new building for 12 adults and flexible rooming and with a suite for the house parents of 2 bedrooms. I designed a new on-site home for the director so there could be more on-site supervision. Remodeled a large barn, rebuilt a shed into a commercial kitchen, and created a master plan for the 13 acres, including overseeing the construction I just described. I set aside land for a large vegetable garden, and I had a small Creek Dam, forming a swimming pond with a beach in the summer and an ice skating rink in the winter. After all, it was Toronto. Back in the 1980s, Henri Nguyen, a Dutch monk turned professor, visited Daybreak for part of his sabbatical. A decade later, when he was diagnosed with terminal cancer, he chose to move back to Daybreak and died there 22 years and 2 weeks ago. He spent his last years in one of the buildings I had designed. Daybreak is simply that kind of place, a place you would choose to go, full of the grace that makes religion imaginable. It is not a place of great intellect, but it is a place of the spirit, of love and peace. Marsh Daybreak continues its work today, and there is a Daybreak facility here in North Carolina as well. Now, Henry's influence was a result of his compassionate involvement in people's lives. He wrote that a religious leader should not be a naive optimist, nor a bitter pessimist. Somehow, the religious person must maintain compassion and hope through the bitter experiences suffered by our friends and neighbors and even most of us ourselves in the course of our lives. Not all this suffering is tragic. Some of it's just a result of the stress of the modern world. In this longer quote from Henry, I'm not going to try to degender it. It just got too complicated. But the word he does, of course, stand for all humanity. Through mass media, Henry writes, he is confronted not only with the most elaborate and expensive attempts to save the life of one man by heart transplant, but also with the powerlessness of the world to help when thousands of people die from lack of food. He is confronted not only with man's ability to travel rapidly to another planet, perhaps he overstated that just a bit, but also with his hopeless impotence to end a senseless war on this planet. He confronted not only high-level discussions about human rights and Christian morality, but also with torture. Not only with incredible ingenuity that can build dams, change riverbeds, and create fertile new lands, but also with earthquakes, floods, and tornadoes that can ruin in 1 hour more than we can build in a generation. A man trying to make sense of all of it cannot possibly deceive himself that one idea or thought system or concept could bring these contrasting images together into a consistent outlook. There's no one possible solution to all the world's ills. This last notion is a critical value for Unitarian Universalists. No one idea, no one revelation, no one institution, no one moral ideology can possibly heal the fragmented world. That's why we are Universalists, why we accept the insight of all the world's religions and of secular literature. We are open to a wider range of voices than our own personal solutions. Despite the new president's campaign rhetoric, no hero alone can save us. We must work together. Now, working together is just another name for the religious purpose. It is what congregations do. They work together. A Catholic priest, now and recognized that this changed entirely the role of a religious leader in the modern world, whom he termed a wounded healer, modeled after the shepherd who protects his flock, the source of our term pastor. Yet I doubt this is an adequate understanding for the modern religious task. There is too much emphasis on sickness and pain and human limitations in Nouwen's metaphor, and far too little of Channing's wonderful optimism and stirring passion. Though Nouwen does avoid the Protestant temptation to blame all problems on human sin. Like Nouwen, I am an optimist, especially in religion. I reacted at an early age to the relentless emphasis on damnation and sin in my own childhood church. A religion that damns so many people for what often seem petty reasons, and that focuses on the evil we do while ignoring the good that we also do, lacks the power to motivate me and the Spirit to comfort me. I lacked confidence in these personal opinions until I found Unitarianism. I was in college, and one day the Ku Klux Klan burned a cross on the lawn of the Unitarian Church, and I've been going ever since. I continue to respect and admire the Methodism of my youth, and I regret that some of you are not very tolerant of much Christian-inspired teachings. But the truth is, we have to move on. At least I think that our future as a religious movement is to make religion more appropriate for a contemporary world. Now, like Nouwen, I have lived through uncomfortable and painful times. I've been frustrated, anxious, depressed, miserable, hurt, angry, and had a hangnail. Yet I have known others whose conditions were much worse than any of mine. I was both relieved to find myself not so bad off as many of my family and friends, and depressed at the depth of pain and misery in our human family. Not even significant surgery for my stage 3 cancer destroyed my optimism, but it did end my naivete. I have suffered little compared to altogether too many other people who share this planet with me. Experience suggests that it's my handsome good looks and brilliance that caused this to happen. Or not. I am an optimist despite my experience and because of my experiences. Because I am no longer a naive optimist expecting the world to become a better place and in my lifetime or sooner. Rather, I am a wounded optimist. Now, there's a term in literary criticism for something like this wounded optimism. It's called romantic irony, and here's an example. Your spouse or partner in a tender moment turns to you and says, "I will love you forever," or "I've never loved anyone more than you." And instead of the joy intended by this remark, you are struck by its hyperbole. You know, given the necessity, your spouse would quickly sacrifice you for the sake of the children and maybe even the dog. Your partner also loves siblings and family and a few really close friends. Romantic irony points out how easily we convince other people, but especially ourselves, that what we want to believe is true really is true, even though we know it is absolutely false. How easily we convince, especially ourselves, that what we want to believe is true, even though we know it's absolutely false. We cannot ignore the painful, depressing, meaningless parts of life by telling ourselves that it's a good world or a perfect world. Integrating the pain and hurt of other people into our understanding and optimism is a sign of maturity, of faith, and of wisdom. To ignore them is at best naive, but usually much worse. I have no rose-colored glasses to face the dawn, yet I welcome with ever-renewed faith the love of friends, the comfort of those I have come to know and love. I know the world's problems can't be solved in a day, but then I'm not quite so arrogant as to think I can solve every problem by tomorrow noon. I'm in the world for the long term, and I have faith that all of you will pick up the load when my time is done. The wounded optimist carries life's pain and suffering along with its joys and love. Pain and suffering help us to understand what it means to be human. When joined with life's joys and successes, we can be compassionate without being maudlin or patronizing. We can be forgiving without seeking vengeance. Prepared for the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune by our wounded optimism, our experiences, and our hopes, we have a faith that can endure life's issues. This is finally the idealist faith, to have dreams so unrealistic that they can never be realized, not only in their lifetime, but in anyone's lifetime. And when they are not, many people become bitter and frustrated and angry, as shown in the 2016 elections. Do not accuse me of lacking optimism because I recognize pain, suffering, failure, ignorance, despotism, poverty, greed, and selfishness. Though wounded, I remain positive and optimistic. My faith in beauty, truth, and goodness, in human reason, initiative, and creativity is undiminished by pain and suffering, ignorance and greed. And perhaps it's even heightened by it. For I have been forgiven. I have been encouraged. I have been comforted in my distress. And I have been loved, not just by family and friends, but sometimes by complete strangers. In light of those experiences, the pain and the hurt, no matter how real, became secondary. My life is buoyed with hope, my spirit energized by love. I look to the better day, not as an observer looks, but as one who, with sleeves rolled up, is in the middle of life. In the midst of the pain and the joy, the hate and the forgiveness, the unselfishness and the love. It is, after all, where I really want to be, not in some far-off perfect heaven, but here, in the middle of life. I invite you to join me to love ever more fiercely, because we know just how fragile are our best efforts, and yet how absolutely important they are to so many people, including so many people we do not know and will never meet. Join me in hope, in pain, and in love. Our closing hymn is